not using the microphone, so give me a little chance here. Thank you, Mark. Let me see, can you just go first? All right. Oh, I did the wrong thing, of course. So, anyway, thank you for being here and thanks for being invited. In 1978, I boarded a Sir Freddie Laker Discount Airlines and flew to Great Britain. I was invited to go and teach at a craft center in the Cotswolds, which is a really beautiful, picturesque part of England. I'm really not an English country potter, but I had some amazing experiences around some of these old potteries, and I trained at the Winchman Pottery in the late 70s. So I'm going to give you a little tour of the old potteries and some of the characters that are there, and then talk a little bit about my life there as I go back and forth. Let's see, whoops. I have gone back, I think I went through all my passports before I came here, and I think it's been 37 trips I've gone back and forth. The little pointer there is the area where the pottery is. And this is a little view of the Cotswolds. It's a very beautiful, pastoral, picturesque part of the world. It's a very rich place in medieval times because of raising sheep, and wool was a big important commodity. So the villages are all full of beautiful little churches and great architecture. And it's full of this extraordinary yellow sandstone that most of the villages and houses are built on. You know, it's a picturesque, a picture book kind of a place. And there are all these little villages that are tucked in the little nooks and the hills and things. It's an incredibly romantic spot, I think. So I first went to England to this place called the Stanley Guildhouse. And the Guildhouse was a center that was dedicated to the development of creative and spiritual potential through arts and fellowship. It was in a little tiny village, and I should go back. This building was built in the 60s, but because of historic preservation, it had to use the local materials, and there were no mines open at the time. So they took down 7 old barns and transported all the stone. This was built entirely by volunteer efforts and led by Mary Osborne, who was the woman, the white-haired woman in the corner. And Mary was an extraordinary woman, kind of difficult in a way, but she was very motivated. She had worked in East London with Gandhi before the war, and Gandhi inspired her to become a weaver and spinner. And from those experiences and being sent out of London during the war, she decided to create this center for handicapped kids and elderly people. And it was mostly a weaving and spinning center, but they also had a pottery school there, and that's what I brought there to teach. The place was very Spartan in a way, but it was full of Winchman pots. And I have to confess that I knew almost nothing about Winchman when I got there. My college experience was a little spotty, as Mark said, and there was almost no history pot when I was going to school. So it was the pots were sort of like half of my epiphany. Seeing those pots was an extraordinary thing. And you can see over the mantelpiece, that big charger, laborare est orare, is also the Jesuit phrase for to work is to pray, which I was also taught by Jesuits when I was in high school, so it's a sentiment that I really think a lot of. And anyway, seeing these pots, I had to find out where they came from. And 7 miles down the road was the Winchman Pottery. And I was down there the very first week, and I regularly visited there for a few months, and eventually convinced Ray that he should give me a job. But the pottery has an amazing history. There has been a pottery on this site for at least 220 years. Again, the little pointer there will show you the actual pottery. It's a little hard to see, but the pottery is there, like all these old country potteries, because of this great clay in the ground. And there was a small, what they call a river earthworm. I would call it a creature. so it was a perfect location. And there was also, at the top of the map, you can see it was a mill. So that waterway was used for all kinds of industry in those days. There was also brickwork, some pile works in this area. And does anybody know what sea cow is? See how it says garden, sea cow, rhubarb, and chicken pots? I have no idea what sea cow is. I'm looking it up, I have no clue. But so they mostly made pots for the farming community. This wasn't domestic or over the table necessarily. It was more, you know, big pans for catching milk, for preserving foods. And then and the history goes back at least 1800. They don't really have records beyond that, but they think it was probably there for longer than that. And then in 1914, the pottery closed. It was, you know, they were trying to compete with industry and they no longer could. And so the employees went back to the land, working on the farms, and the pottery sat derelict for 12 years, closing 14. And then in 1926, Michael Cardew was visiting Broadway, which is a really beautiful town nearby, and he came across the empty pottery and made inquiries and eventually leased it. And I think that I saw that at least for about 50 feet a week. But everything was there. And so these first few pictures are just some of the old pottery remains. So this bottle kiln is an extraordinary thing. And there's an effort right now to preserve it, as it's a quite a unique thing in this area. It was abandoned in the 50s, and they moved to stoneware. But I love this picture on the left. You can see how many layers of brick in the walls of that thing. It has five fireboxes ringing around it. And this kiln, for most of its life, was inside a building. You can see those two roof lines. If you connect the dots, you can see that that was inside the building, but they kept burning it down. It was no surprise. They literally wrapped it laying on the brickwork itself. I can go back for a second to show you. So the door at the bottom, the wick at the bottom, is where they glazed, where they put the glazeware. Most of it was in staggers. They used coal as well as wood to fire this thing. And the top chamber, there's two distinct chambers, which is a dome inside where the thing starts to taper, and they loaded biscuit fire in the top. And that was loaded into the second floor. So it was a very efficient kiln, you know, the temperature loss from the glazed chamber to the top chamber, a lot of the biscuit fire as well. I'm not gonna talk a lot about Cardew. I'm sure I get it wrong, and Margaret's up there glare at me. Famously, they struggled with this kiln. It was a kiln that they struggled to make it work. Eventually did get it figured out, but earthenware kind of started to fade in the 50s, and the clay played out, which was the biggest thing about the machines. The clay was getting, in fact, you can see on that big pot down in the right-hand corner, there's a big white spot, and that's a pot out from, thank you for plaster, from, so calcium. So the clay was getting worse and worse and worse, so eventually you go to stone. So that's the back of the kiln there. So they were, for all these years, they were digging the clay by hand and then processing it. So that's a plug mill on the left. And then this is the early crew. This is Michael in the middle, and Sidney Dustin and his brother, and then Elijah Comfort is the little man on the left. And that horse, who has a funny name, I'm not going to repeat, was a horse that was used. This is also cider country. So a cider press is operating the same idea is these plug mills, and that the horse walked around a circle and drove the screw, which then processed the clay. I have a picture here. It's a bit older, but give you an idea. Last year, I discovered this little old cider mill in the village where I stay, and it was a room just big enough for the horse to walk around inside, with, you know, inches to spare around the walls. So this is a lot of labor. I have to say, I've always been grateful when they stopped doing this by the time I got there, because it would have been my job. You know, I was the lad. And then in the pottery was this old treadle wheel, which I just find so amusing. You can see it was in a couple fires. It was burned up. And when they decided to pour concrete in that room, they just poured it around the closet. See this little notch around there and everything. And this was a wheel that was just used for waxing pots and decorating. The pottery, by the time I got there, everybody was using electric wheels. So, you can tell I was having fun with pottery. I love this picture. Sydney, Tustin, and Ray, and Michael. There's almost 200 years of pottery. And I just, those faces just are incredible. I just love how they all look. There's none of this hugging American hands. So I'm just going to show a couple of Michael's pots. Michael was, of course, an extraordinary maker, and his legacy, I think, was carried on long after he left, I guess. Ray often described his life as sort of refining Michael's ideas. He was a very modest guy. He did a lot more than that, but that's how he sort of saw his role carried forward by his ideas. And I love the taper on the spot of that pot. It's a huge, huge teapot. And of course, you know, I will express one opinion here, which is I think that Michael's work on earthenware pots, to me, are the greatest pots he ever made. There's so much life to them. A lot of them were had flaws and glaze problems because they really struggled with the kiln. They're using lead glazes, and this jug on the left, I think, has got blisters all over it. But they just had a real power to them, I think. On the right is my mother garden pot. I was digging in the garden one day, and I found the shirt up on the top. And if you see the stamp, it's you can see the C in the part of the end there. And that's my own electrocardiogram. And the shirt is this big, so it must have been a giant charger. But you could not put a shovel in the ground in that place without pulling up the pottery. It was just amazing. So Michael comes to Winchcombe, he leases the pottery, and he hires back Elijah Comfort. Elijah had worked at the old pottery and then had gone back onto the land, and he was a prodigious thrower. I think he probably saved Michael's bacon because he can throw like all his business. And he's actually, these casseroles and these big open dishes and things was a lot of what he made. You can see he's making a lid that would fit a casserole just like that. Most of the decoration Michael did, Michael brought decoration to it. They would not have done much decorating for him. And Elijah was deaf as a post and had a very funny relationship with Michael. I think Tanya Harrod in her book alluded to the fact that Elijah knew how to fire the kiln, but he wouldn't offer that information to Michael. And Michael wouldn't have asked him, I don't think. In my own sort of estimation, maybe it was about class or something, but Elijah was getting paid every week, and I didn't really care that much. So, because it took them a long time to figure it out. And this is just a lovely atmosphere. So this is upstairs. In that old kiln shed, and that's Elijah on the right and Sydney on the left. And I love, you can see Sydney's wearing a waistcoat and a tie. And even when I came to the pottery, there were still people showing up dressed like this. I really like that. And you can see all the saggers up in the corner. It's a really great time for this. And there's Sydney. Sydney worked at the pottery for 51 years. He kept a record of all the pots that he made, and he made over a million. Every day at the end of the day, in his notebook, I'm sorry, reported it. So he retired, and as he left, everybody on the team kind of went up a step, and I came in the bottom. When I was there, it was a really exciting time, because the pottery, there was a huge interest in the pottery in those days, and Sydney continued to come back in his retirement and pack all the pots to ship, but, we were shipping to Macy's in New York, Scandinavia, and there was a series of vegetarian restaurants called Cranks that we provided every pot to the table. And we used to take a truckload of pots every month into London for Cranks. So it really allowed Ray to have a bigger team, and it was probably the only time the pottery was ever really prosperous. Sydney was at heart a red clay maker. He resisted the change to stoneware in the 50s. In fact, caused some tension for a while as he and Ray. Ray got electric kiln and let him still do it for a while. sort of pulled the plug. But Sydney made a lot of the smallest work, you know, like egg cups, to these little couriers and things. But he had a beautiful and deft hand with flip turtle and combing and things like that. And so these are all examples of his work. You can find lots of Sydney spots on eBay. He was so prolific, and they're fairly affordable and really charming. I asked him one day to sit down and show me all of his trail. And so I got this slate table and just started showing all these different designs. It was really wonderful. And Doug knows, because Doug has filmed him quite a bit, but Sydney liked to show what he did. He was very proud of this, as he should have been. And then this is my man. This is Ray Finch. So my book came in 26. In 1935, Ray, who had seen pottery in London, came out to Lindstrom and asked Michael for a job. And Michael asked him what his experience was, and he had none, so he said, go and learn to make pots. So Ray went back to London for a year, studied, and then came back a year later, and Michael gave him a job. He then worked there for 70-some years. Ray died about 4 years ago at the age of 96. He was still making pots at 95. He was still putting tests in the kiln, trying to learn something, which is, to me, an extraordinarily inspiring thing. And I hope I can be so lucky. He was a very modest, quiet guy. You know, most potters, we have our egos. Ray was as egolessness of a potter as I've probably ever known. He could have. He was so influential in a really, really quiet way. He's trained over 90 potters around the world in his lifetime. He took the pottery from earthenware and stoneware. He is the person who really took the brewery box idea around the bottle kilns and adapted it to a more conventional Roman arch kiln, and really built one of the very first, if not the first, kiln of that kind. In 3 years, potters came to Lindstrom to learn about that idea of brewery box firing. You know, he was a magnificent maker, and this is some of his earliest work. I was really lucky to be there towards the end of my stay. He had a huge exhibition at the Craft Potters Association in London, and that whole time I was there, he was preparing for that show, so he was culling all the best work, and that show sold out in about half an hour. And back in those days, those didn't happen. This is a stoneware charger Ray's, and most of the work, and I'll show you some, it was very simple standard ware, but he did have some work that was a little more personal. I mean, these large chargers, they're called the platters. They're just a lot of, you know, what he tried to do was to take some of the ideas of the earthenware decoration and bring it into stoneware. So instead of the red clay with a white slip, it was a buff gray clay, and they often use iron slips on top. And they do them the same techniques across. The pot on the right is a glazed trailer. He did quite a bit. And around the left, it's a zircon glaze, and he's just scratched through it. And then his teapots, I'm a nut for teapots, and he made beautiful ones. And these are big gardener teapots. This pot, and I have another one that were made 10 years apart, one fired in salt, one fired in wood. And the lids are absolutely interchangeable. His skill, you know, and sometimes you can have skill in the art, but his skill is extraordinary. I can't do that. So another member of the team is Eddie Hopkins. And if anybody ever knew Eddie, he was just a bigger-than-life character. He became a potter because he was a rogue as a young man. He was a teddy boy. And he kept getting in trouble. He was in a motorbike gang. And he was given a choice to go to a boys' camp or to go to Greenwich Abbey, which was the local abbey that supported itself by making pottery. And so Eddie learned to make pots there as he was sort of being corrected. But he was the workhorse of the pottery. He was a local man. He'd only left the county twice in his life when I met him. And very rooted. I mean, this is, to me, coming from America, to come to this rural area and find people who are living, you know, almost a century ago, it felt like to me. When the village he grew up in, when the lady commander was in the village, everyone doffed their caps and went through town. And so to me, an extraordinarily different and fascinating life. I learned a lot from Eddie. We became very close friends. He taught me how to drink good beer. He taught me how to make good handles. He would, these mugs he's making, these are all happening in the morning. And he would make and handle 500 mugs in about four and a half days. And I used to stack them in the biscuit kiln, 7 high. And the stacks were just like the lids. You know, just the skill of these men is just astonishing. And Eddie didn't have a lot of art in him. If you gave him a lump of clay and said, make something you want to make, it often was not that interesting. But he could mimic like nobody's business. And the lot, all these were made for cranks for this restaurant. So this, the volume proved important. They don't want to give you 2 ounces extra coffee for your cup. But Eddie's nature was to make these really voluptuous round pots that raised to come back once in a while and bring them a sample. They were straight from the pump. And then Eddie would be right back there. And he was a big jug maker, although these are, he's actually holding raised jugs in his hand. And the thing I like about this picture is there's no effort in holding that pot in his hands, if you can tell. It's just so beautifully thrown. And that's one of Ed's on the right. He very sadly passed away shortly after he retired. But, and so these are jugs like the one he was holding. On the left, those are bread crocks, which you see often in England. And these were, you know, the bread crocks actually were an easy sell in those days, but you know, the big jugs and things were sort of the specials that were made of pottery. And there's Ed himself, there's the Winchcombe stamp. You know, we used to keep track of the trailer with the clay coming in. And someone was mentioning that the high class mine was closed, is that correct?
Yeah.
So I don't know where Ballpay's coming from, but, and I believe 67 refers to the silica content. The clay body was a really high silica content, very, very dense Ballpay body. Beautiful, beautiful throwing body, I felt. And there's a dough mixer on the right. Even though this is the contemporary pottery now, it still had a lot of sort of industrial revolutionary equipment. Big belts you can see on that thing. So there's a blunder on the left, which was for mixing slips. That's a ball mill on the right, picture on the left. And then that's a vertical plug mill there on the right. So no more horses when you're on circles. And the kiln shed, the kiln's really, it's really narrow, so it's hard to get a good picture. But this is a giant two fireboxes, one either side of this big chamber. I used to have to prepare 140 shells for every fire. We were firing about every 3 weeks when I was there. It was, you know, it was big time production, and very, very, very affordable pots. So that's just a view of the firebox. You know, always tricky these doors to get them down. And this is a terrible picture, but I did want to show you this because one of Ray's really amazing innovations is. You can see the bricks along the middle on the side there of the firebox. That's primary air, and it's brought in, and then there's a false wall inside, so the air is drawn up, and then it comes in up over the top of the arch of the firebox. So that air is getting super heated before it comes in contact with the fuel, which makes for really efficient burning. When I was there, they were biscuit firing. Over the years, sometimes they were all away, sometimes a biscuit fire. But you can see the maintenance of oil burners, which are despicable. Heated oil burners. They're filthy. Part of my job was out in the woodlock. It's all pine slabs. And at various times, and I think Nick kind of alluded to this too, sometimes wood was very difficult for the pottery to get a hold of. And there aren't big, vast forests in Britain. And even I'm having trouble with where I live because everybody's chipping all of the slab stuff. They don't want me to handle it. And here's a couple of shots around the workshop. It was really a production place. Those are all glaze buckets in front. And lots of beautiful, robust belly jugs, which I really do love. I'm not that great at making them. I leave that to Doug. It was a wholesale and retail business, and this is a wholesale price list that came before my days. I think it's at 75, I was there at 78, and it's in old money, so I have no idea what the prices mean. But they're enormously affordable. But there was a standard line that was made over and over and over again. So you could come back 10 years later and add pieces to your collection if you wanted to. When I came back to the States, I thought that's what potters had to do. It took me a long time to kind of let go of that idea, that I could continue to grow and make new pots. So this is the showroom, and this is the two standard lines of the pottery. We call the stuff on the right GIO, glazed inside only. So that's all just flashing from the wood firing. A very responsive clay body, obviously. And then on the left was this beautiful tomoku. Sometimes it was iron slip with a celadon glaze over the top. But those were, in those days, they've gotten a little bit more colorful since these days, and not necessarily crude. Very simple, but beautiful posterior book, I would say. And this is a real, you know, classic example of the standard wear. Just really warm, but quiet. Notice that teapot's got a chip on its front. So there were lots going on when I was there. Ray had begun to get interested in salt glazing. And he'd gone from earthenware to stoneware, and I think he was needed another challenge. So I was really fortunate when I was there that he and Toff and I, on our hours outside of the pottery hours, we built this little salt kiln out of all just stuff laying around on the property. And the insulating brick, this was really interesting to me, was made with coal ash from coal power factories somewhere in Britain. The inside was hard brick, but the insulation was this weird brick. To the left of that is the famous Michael Carvey hut. Carvey lived in the pottery with his family for a while. It was just really horrible. And then he built this little hut, and the river actually runs right behind it. And the story is that he jumped in the river every day. I can tell you, in the wintertime, it's not appealing sight. It started out being wood-fired. Eventually, the proportions that Ray designed really didn't work very well, so we assisted with oil burners. And I used to have to fill an oil barrel and then roll it all across the property and then up a hill behind it and then up onto, we built a platform to put it up there so it was gravity-fed. They never wanted to spend a penny. So we had to sort of invent things, which was really fantastic, truthfully. And so I got to spend all this time with Ray on the left, that's my great friend, Toff Mill in the middle, learning about, you know, starting from scratch with the new kiln and exploring it. And those two were incredibly close friends, and Toff's a really brilliant chemist and engineer. So just watching those two figure out the problems, and although I'm going to talk all day long, I do want to shut up and listen, because they were just so good at, you know, bouncing ideas off each other and saying, what if we do this in the future? This is a very memorable night, because this is the first night I ever heard Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy on the radio. It was so atmospheric, as that is. So these are some of the salt-based pots. And again, you know, beautiful combing, going back to the earthenware days. Incredibly fulsome, round, robust shapes. The cider jar on the left is my favorite pot in the world. I can't get it off the top, they won't give it to me. But ask them to put it in his will to me. But, you know, very simple, but the clay body took the salt really well, but in this day at times he was using these kaolin slips, which kind of resisted the salt. So that you got this real beautiful silky surfaces, and only where you got real heavy salt that you get orange peel happening. And that contrast of that surface, I think, is really rich. These are the two I made. I don't know what happened to me. I made some okay pots when I was there, and then I came back to America, and it was terrible for a while. I did not make pots for the pottery. I was there to serve these guys, and so I had a wheel. Right next to Ray's, which is crazy, so intimidating. But I can make pots in the evenings, not in the end if I wanted to. But I didn't keep very many, you know, to make a mediocre pot in that building just didn't seem right. So I kept a few, you know, to go to France and things like that. So my most important job, if you ask anybody at the pottery, was making tea. And tea has become a huge part of my life. In fact, I'm going to have a little sip right now. As I say, I'll get to it. Somebody wanted the last one. Everybody had their own mugs. And so I think I have it all right. I set it up, everybody comes, but I'm 3 minutes late. And there's only 15 minutes, but it's like from 10 to 10 to 15. So if I don't have the tea ready, they have until 10:03, they've lost 3 minutes. So I really had to be on my best. And so I do all this, and Bob walks in and takes a sip of his tea and spits it all over us. So that's the worst cup of tea I've ever had in my life. That's cringy in the corner, but that, it took me a while to sort of understand I was being tested. A couple more. This is the other big teapot with the lids switch. So, you know, my job was to make the tea, I stack the wood, I glaze pots, I help make clay, I loaded the kilns and unloaded the kilns. So I often say I made very few pots there, but I handled every pot in that pottery for almost 2 years. And I believe that a great deal of information comes to us, not just visually, but from, you know, holding a good pot and knowing where the balance is and, you know, the feeling to the pot. I felt like I took information in this way, as well as, you know, observation and conversation. And one of the things that, you know, is wonderful about traditional pottery is that we're all making pots that, you know, are based on pots before. And I know this pot on the right was talked about earlier. This is at the V&A. And the forms at Winchcombe really derive from two different sources. This sort of upright medieval jug, and that's a Eddie Hopkins on the left. And then the other influence was English slipware, these robust round belly pots. And, you know, I'm not suggesting that there's really connections here, but I saw pictures and shapes that looked similar, so I'm showing them off. This jug on the right is a kind of unusual one. It's sort of the typical Winchcombe shape, but it's like pulled horizontally. And when Ray made it, I had the temerity to say, Ray, I think he finally made a pot I don't like. And then it came out of the kiln, and it was wonderful. And then he did. that was his way of like poking me. But, you know, those two, basically those two ideas are what informs all the forms of the pottery. And, you know, they change them all and grow, and it's wonderful to be a part of that. So this is the team as I, when I was there, and I'm doing well. In addition to the six potters that were there, on the site there was a woodworker, a wood turner, and a sculptor. So the tea room was always full of these people, and there were always plenty of guests. Ray's in the middle, his son Mike is to the right of me, if you can figure out who I am. And that's Top Milway to the right, and Eddie with his son. It was an extraordinary time for me. And I've made deep friendships when I was there. And as Mark alluded to, I have since been going back to Ames every year since. I came back to America at the end of 1979, and through an ad in the back of Ceramics Monthly, I got a job managing a pottery in Fredericksburg, Virginia. And I've been there ever since. I had a shop downtown for many, many years. And those are all tea chests you're seeing in front of the pottery. Every summer I would go over for 2 months, make work, and then I would ship it by sea back to the States. In those days, it was pretty affordable to do so, and pretty easy. It's a lot more difficult now because of security fears and all this sort of stuff. And I can't use tea chests anymore because the wood is approved to be insect-free, things like this. But everybody in England has one of these in the garage, it seems to me. I have made my work in Fredericksburg all these years. On the side of my building, a friend of mine painted this amazing mural with some of my heroes and icons. And then about 8 years ago, we had a visit from Hannah and Doug. There's no way I couldn't show. I hope Hannah's here. That's Bernard Leach that Doug is cozying up to. Doug and Hannah did a wonderful workshop at the art center that I used to run, and just at the end of it, we had time to go over to this crazy Frisbee festival that friends of mine promote. So there they are having their very first drink of moonshine. One of the things that, you know, has been great for me going back and forth was getting to know people, and I've been able to, you know, bring folks like Glenn Hand over for workshops in the past, and it's really, we have a grand time, and lots of things have come from that experience. So, I'm going to tell you a little bit now about what I do nowadays. That's Toph Milloway with me, and Toph and I became fast friends. He really, it took me about a week to figure out, because he was the one who was pushing and testing me. He presented me with this book when I arrived. One up the chair. And this is a series of books by Stephen Potter, who also toured America and wrote a fascinating book about his observations of Americans. But this is a tongue-in-cheek book about how a proper Englishman sort of, you know, engages in one-upmanship. And I will tell you, it set a tone for my entire visit, probably my entire friendship with Toph. But it was just this thing, you know, it was a test. You know, I read it, I understood it, I got the game, and forever on, we've been great close friends. So Toph worked at the Pottery for a number of years. He's had an amazing career. Toph was, he started making pots in Ireland, and then he went to the Harrow School, which was mentioned a couple times this weekend. The Harrow School was a really short-lived, but really influential two-year program at the college called Harrow outside of London. And it was a two-year program where people, you know, did everything. They built kilns one day, going down the next day. Salt Lake was a big part of it. A lot of Salt Lake's potters, I think, kind of came from that place. So when Toph left Winchcombe, he also worked in Kalanyama in Africa, ran a pottery down there for a while. He spent time in Kenya with an organization going out and finding great pots out in the bush and bringing them to Europe to make better money for some of the makers. So it's a really fascinating career. And then he moved to this village called Converton in 86. It's a beautiful Cotswold village, right on the edge of the Cotswolds, kind of. It's still made from beautiful stone. And this is where I spend almost every summer. It kind of started out just, you know, visiting his friends, and then when they had children, it became really useful if I could come over for the summer and run the shop, because they have a very strong retail business at their shop. It's this really beautiful village, lots of people come through. And school holidays are quite brief in Britain, so in the middle of the high season was when they could go on holiday. So I would come and make my work, and take care of the garden, and sell pots, and take care of the garden is a big, big job. It's a really beautiful, beautiful spot. This was an old forge, and this whole village is part of an estate that owns two villages and all the land between and around, and it's a family that has had it for many, many generations. The village that Toph was in was built for all the workers on the estate, and the next village was all the family lived. So much more elegant architecture in that place. And this was the blacksmith's shed. Lots of beautiful flowers everywhere. And the estate at one time had an orchard as part of their, they were making money-making schemes, but over the years that became, it just wasn't viable for them. So these are all plum trees that you're seeing here. And when Toph and Georgie leased the property, they came along with this huge orchard for apples and pears, seven different kinds of plums. And truthfully, a lot of my summer is, if I were to really tell the guy at customs, I would tell him, I'm a tender fruit picker. Because I've picked thousands of pounds of plums over the years. And there's a few of them. Those green plums called green gauge is the sweetest thing you've ever eaten. When they come ripe, all of a sudden, the Millways have a lot more friends. It's an old variety of fruit, and old timers know about it and know where it is. This whole area is a very fertile place that I mentioned earlier. This is in a place called the Vale of Evesham, which was a very fertile place that was farmed by small families and small holdings. They intensely produced produce, which all went into London. And I have a friend, he's passed away now, a little boy, who would tell stories of driving a donkey cart with fruit and vegetables to the train station. And you know, to have the opportunity to know folks who live this life is very rare, I would say. This is supposed to be a video. Oops, go back on the side now. So taking care of Toph and George's place also meant, done something, haven't I? They had this parrot, which hated my guts. And I had to take care of it, and I had to give it tea twice a week. And so he's drinking tea, and I'm sorry, this video's not playing, but it's hilarious. Toph Jones, a nice cup of tea. But he would dip his head in there, but he'd always be eyeballing your hand at the same time. And if you weren't careful, man, he'd go for you. So the things I do for my friends. So Toph's workshop, this again, his little forge, this place was black as you could imagine when he first came there. I went over to help him set up and build the place. This is his terribly busy workshop. It drives me crazy. And his kiln, it's again hard to picture because it's in a tight space, but Toph does salt glaze, gas-fired salt glaze, and his kiln is got a soft brick interior. And so that on the right, you can see the surface of those bricks fall. And this is the second kiln that he's had. When we took down the first one after about 180 firings, the bricks were maybe, I don't know, there might have been a quarter inch of the brick that was really gone over all those firings. But this stuff kind of can flake off and things, so he has to set the pots clean a little bit. And then he caps, he's got almost no arch on his kiln, it's almost a flat arch, because he has to cap the top with shelves to collect any of the stuff that falls. But that being said, it's very efficient to fire because of the insulation. And I think that the soft brick in Britain may have a higher aluminum content than ours. I'm not really sure, because I've put some soft bricks in my kiln. It does not like it. All raw fired work. And Toph, really his work is a continuation of sort of a Lindstrom idea of repetition where he does make a lot of one-offs, but he's very consistent in making this repetition layer. His work is really more influenced by Mick Casson, who was mentioned yesterday. It's sort of his aesthetic, I would say, was formed before he came to Lindstrom, and I think that he really is closer to Mick's idea of pottery. So this is the showroom, which is really charming. It's all this Irish furniture. Dead animals on the walls. this is really why I go to the Cotswolds. Because we sit at this beautiful table and we eat fantastic food. The British have a terrible reputation for food, but it's an old idea. You know, especially out of the country. You know, my friends, the meat they eat comes from the farmer that farms around them. You know, they're very close to the land. Cheeses in the world, it's not France, but they have marvelous cheeses. There's been a little revival in the farmhouse for the production, and local food is real there too. We live very, very well. Stop it. This is very sensitive. Okay. So these are a couple of Toph's bigger pots. He started doing these fish. You know, the British are crazy for salmon. And one day, a guy came and asked him for a big platter to serve salmon on, and that led him down the road. It's funny how one thing can sort of create a whole new body of work for you. So fish became a thing for Toph. In a way, my birdie pots are a response to that, one of them. So these are some of his more spectacular work. Those fish, which are now three-dimensional on the casserole things, they started out by throwing a ring and make a ring pot. And he makes them with paper clay, and then he cuts them and pulls them like pulling a handle. And the paper clay keeps them from lifting off the pots. And they're quite outrageous, but we all have to express ourselves. This is some of his more standard wear. He makes these long, skinny jugs, and he's kind of a skinny boy himself. And I always say I make round jugs because I'm round. I'm getting rounder. Most of the work is just slipped, he's a great believer in simple. So, he says, one glaze liner, two slips, the variation, the kiln glaze liner is plenty to deal with. And like all of us, he does other things, but that's his main sort of idea. So there's a salmon platter. And they were very, very rich. They looked much better up there. And I guess these olive and crockpot funny had something to do with this machine, I guess. There's some cheese, I didn't show you that. I confess I brought some illegal cheeses all that summer. It was fantastic. And they never even looked at me. I could have brought up a suitcase for them. So there's a fish handle jug. And the reason he used a paper clay is that handle used to lift off when they wanted to go back to its full roundness. And so I started using paper clay and it solved it instantly. Beautiful Aladdin teapot with porous dirt. It's really shit. And I actually own this pot, and it's quite a huge teapot. And this sort of faceted technique David Leach used with it, even though he was porcelain work, which is really magnificent. Just a hacksaw blade with a little notch in it. I mean, not really taking much clay off, but it does leave that sort of second little notch there, which is really sweet. And Toff does this really funny in this firing. After he salts, he puts the kiln back into reduction for quite a long time, and that creates a luster. My first PowerPoint. No, I'm not even going to show you those pictures. Sorry. So it puts this incredible luster on the surface. It's almost like a oil slick. Let me see up close. These are actually pots that I've made over there. In some ways, it's a cheat. You know, I just make my pots and I stick them in this kiln and let them put these beautiful surfaces on them. As they say, I brought these pots back to America for many, many years. And the only time I ever had a line of people in front of my shop waiting for me to open is when I could bring these pots back. The pots of Native America never engendered that same interest. But they were enormously rich. And to the credit of my customers, because I had a lot of repeat customers, they kind of liked the idea that I went over there and brought pots back and wanted to support my efforts. And I'm always amazed at that idea, which happens all the time in my life. I just work in them. You're happy for me, you don't buy my pots, so I can buy a few of them. So I'm going to kind of end it up here. I have a great privilege to spend time with these incredible countrymen. And I was telling them the story the other night that I think because I'm an American in this area, and I can't, my accent doesn't give away my background, like it may if you were in England. And these are country boys, lived in the village. Toff and Georgie never crossed their threshold. Because Toff and Georgie are sort of middle class, I would say. These guys are definitely working class on the land. This is Vernon. Hustle, cousin Vernon, we call him, who what I consider the last of the market gardeners. He was still doing this intensive vegetable production, but out behind it all was a shed with thousands of gallons of ciders. He was a bootleg cider maker, and it's called Scrumpy in lots of country areas. It's lethal. He would get old rum barrels and put the cider in there so there was no extra alcohol and flavor, and I had the great privilege of almost being required to come every time I visited, to come to this shed. You can see he's in the shed with the bubble wrap insulation. There's these barrels everywhere seeping with cider, and he had racing pigeons and a pet chicken was still underneath. And you can see way up in the corner above the barrels, there's a little, I used to use this caricature in my business, and they kept that in there for years and years and years. And the fact that an American came to hang with them was a thrill. Again, Vernon never left the county. It was a really great privilege. So, you know, besides my life interacting with the craftspeople and the pottery in this area, and Cotswolds was famous, you know, in the arts and crafts movement, I also had an entree into these other worlds that were nothing to do with pottery, but made my life really rich. I've documented these guys over the years. I'm so sorry that these videos aren't working because when they speak, it's a language that is actually gone almost now. It's a very country Gloucestershire accent. Anyway, I believe that's the last. I'm going to show you, and I think